Looking back over the various videos I've done in the past few months, it really is remarkable how many of them relate to the ienumerable interface in one way or another, because it really is the interface that keeps on giving. There are so many facets to it, so many different ways you can use it, and actually it's leading on to the next two videos, because what I'm going to look at this week and next week are the keywords yield return, or really the key phrase yield return, that we use the two words together side by side. Introduced in C# version 2, which is what I'm going to look at this time, and then new features added to it in C# version 8, which we'll move on to the next time. But let's just take a look at what we were doing a few videos back when I first talked about how to implement the ienumerable interface. Because if you remember, take a look if you don't remember, but if you remember, we had this idea of a library being a collection of books. And the actual implementation of the collection of books was just to put them in an existing collection, a list. Very common thing you do. It's actually quite rare that we write a collection completely from scratch. We usually base it on another one, so a library is really just wrapping up a list of books. And then the thing we needed to do, because we've got the ienumerable interface, that means we've got to implement that with our getEnumerator method that returns an ienumerator of books. And we saw the easy way to do that was simply to delegate that down to the getEnumerator for the list, because it's doing the same job, and that's what you do in most cases. To show you how things work under the covers, and something you'll have to do much less commonly, is write your own enumerator. So we had this book enumerator, and what we had in there was that the book enumerator took into its constructor a reference to the actual library that we're going to be enumerating through, had this index we set to -1, and then had these various methods whereby we had the move next that incremented the index and then checked whether we'd gone off the end. We had the reset that took us back to just before the beginning. And then we had the current that just returned the book at the current position marked by the index. And actually, writing an enumerator like that is a fairly mechanical process. The actual details of what's going to go on, although they're not always going to be the same, are very often going to be the same. And so it's the sort of thing we might think could be generated for us with rather less coding for ourselves. And that really was the thing that was introduced in C# 2 when we had this idea of the yield return. Because a third way we can implement the getEnumerator is like this. What we could do is simply write a loop to loop through the books inside the getEnumerator. So I could simply write something like for and then int idx. I could actually have done this with a for each loop, but I wanted to do it with a for loop just so we can really see the parallels with the enumerator we looked at a moment ago. And so we'll say for idx equals 0, idx is less than, and then we've got books.count plus plus idx, so just looping through. And then this is where we do the weird thing. We say yield return, so that's the phrase yield return, always those two words together, and then the element we want to return. So here we're going to say underscore books square brackets idx. And that looks really very, very weird in terms of breaking certainly some of the rules you might think of the C# language, and also in terms of its behavior. But the fact is, a yield return is not exactly the same as a return. If we say return, we simply say return this value and leave the function will terminate. When we say yield return, although we are effectively returning the value, so the book at position idx, the fact we've said yield return also says don't leave the function completely, effectively take a snapshot of the state of every one of the local variables within this function. In this case, it's just idx, but it basically means it will return, but it will remember the value of idx. And then the next time we come into this function in the correct circumstances, then it won't just start the function anew and set idx to 0. It will pick up where it left off. So effectively, each time we call this function, we'll go to that yield return. IDX will be incremented by one each time. We'll return that book, but we'll remember where we are so that next time we come in, we pick up from where we left off. And effectively, that is doing exactly the same as we had in our book enumerator. In our book enumerator, in order to remember where we had to have IDX as a private member of the class. That's the way you'd normally keep something for the long term. But effectively what's happened is by writing this yield return, we have caused the C# compiler to, underneath the covers, generate something that would look pretty much like that book enumerator. Let's just to begin with prove that that works. So let's go to program, and here we've just created our books, and then we've got a for each loop. And remember, the for each loop relies upon having a get enumerator and it working. So if we just run that up, then we can see it's looped through. We've got all those features, and we can use ienumerable in the same way we saw before. So we can use the extension methods and that sort of thing as well. So that's what we've got. We can, in any circumstance where we have a return type of ienumerator, in this case ienumerator of book, you can either obviously return an object of that type, which is what we're doing with returning your book enumerator or with getting the one off the list, but also you can yield return an element of the type for which the generic is instantiated. Okay, so return, it has to be ienumerator of book. Yield return, it's simply going to be book. And then when we terminate, so when we don't do a yield return, when we simply run off the end of the function, that's where effectively the move next that's generated will return false to say that you've reached the end. So although actually in practice, I would say in this case, it's still better just to delegate down to the enumerator for the underlying list. It's much easier, if that's not an option, to use the yield return than to write your own enumerator. So another reason why, although it's interesting to see, there's far too much unnecessary code written in that book enumerator. We can just use that yield return. So that's one use of the yield return situation where we have our get enumerator returning ienumerator, in this case of book, we yield return a single book. The other slight variation on that is not only can we yield return to a function that's returning an ienumerator, we can also yield return to a function that is returning an ienumerable of whatever type it may be, book. Let me just show you that. So what I'm going to do here is over in this other project, let's just set that as a startup, we've got this enum where we're simply declaring an enum for days of the week, and we've got Sunday through to Saturday. And something you'd quite often want to do with that is have a way of looping through all of those days. And that's something you could do on the fly, but I'm going to put together a little class here just to make life easier. So we're going to have a public static class that I'm going to call day enumeration. And in that, I'm going to put a public static property that's going to return an ienumerable of day of week. And I'm going to call this all. And actually, the code for this is very standard, something that you'll see in lots and lots of situations. What we're going to do is we're going to use the enum class. We're going to say get values. We're going to say which enum we want those values for, which is going to be day of week. And then the only problem is get values just returns an array of objects. So we can then do a cast to convert that to an ienumerable of the correct type, which is going to be day of week. So a little bit fiddly, all of that, but that's necessary to get the typing right. And although you could use this directly, because it's a bit fiddly, it's nice to wrap that up and give us that all. So just to show us using that, what we could do now is if we go to the program here, I could simply say for each var day in day enumeration dot all, and then we can do a console write day, and that should give us just all of the days of the week, simple enough. And so if you want to loop through all of the elements in an enumeration, then it's pretty simple. But very often we might want to loop through subsets of enumeration. So here we might want to have subsets where we could go for maybe weekdays. So I might want to have a public static ienumerable day of week. So starts off the same. And then we would just call this weekday. So it's going to return Monday through Friday. And so I won't do it inline because it's a bit more complicated. We'll put a getter in here. But how might we go about that approach of picking out the weekdays from that complete days of week? It's a simple enough problem to frame. We know it's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday, but writing the code could be a bit tricky. And that's another place that yield return becomes absolutely beautiful, because just like if we had an ienumerator of day of week, also with an ienumeral of day of week, you're allowed to do a yield return of a particular day of the week. So all we do here is we say yield return day of week dot, and then the first day of the week is Monday. And then all we've got to do is just pop those in. And list them one after the other with the yield return. And although that may look a bit different from what we had before, it's actually doing exactly the same thing. Remember what we saw in the library was when you do a yield return, it remembers the exact state of the function, and the next time you come in, it picks up from where you left off. And that's precisely what's happening here. So the first time we try to iterate through this, we'll do a yield return of Monday. We'll leave the function at that point, but it will remember where we are. And so next time we come in, we'll pick up with Tuesday. Then we'll leave, come in again, pick up with Wednesday, and so on and so forth. So we don't really need to write a loop. You might think this is kind of hard-coded, it's a bit ad hoc, but this is one of those circumstances where that makes sense. There are circumstances where it's easier just to say the days of the week are Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, rather than trying to do anything clever. Once again, after Friday, when we then just run off the end, that's effectively the move next returning false, and so we finish the loop. And so now I can go back to my program there. And in this case, rather than doing all, we'll just do weekdays. And when we run that, we can see it just loops through. Last thing I want to show you is a way to use yield return to generate mathematical sequences that are unlimited, that could go on for as long as you like, but have a definite mathematical way of calculating each new feature. And the one I was going to look at was the one beloved of mathematicians and fiction writers and all sorts of other people, the Fibonacci series. So the Fibonacci series, remember how that works. The first two numbers are 0 and 1, and then each subsequent number, you just add together the previous two. So after 0 and 1, you've got 1, then that's 1 and 1 add together to give 2, then 2 and 1 add together to give 3, 3 and 2 add together to give 5, 5 and 3 give you 8, and so on and so forth. Just as an aside, I was watching a really fascinating video on this about Fibonacci numbers that aren't simply whole positive numbers, but was looking at negative Fibonacci numbers, fractional Fibonacci numbers, and even complex Fibonacci numbers. None of which we're going to look at here, but I've put up a link because it really was interesting if you're into that sort of thing. But we're going to keep it simple. We're just going to look at the normal sequence, but show how coding that up using yield return is a really easy thing to do. So let's add in here a new class called Fibonacci. And again, I'm going to make this a static class. And then I'm going to give this a public static ienumerable of int. I'm doing all these statics just because it's easier for the demos. You can have these yield returns on any type of method or property as we saw. And then we will just call this sequence. And then we're going to have a length, the number of elements in the sequence. So remember, the way that the Fibonacci works is we add together the two previous numbers. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say here int n, let's call it n0, equals 0, and int n1 equals 1. So remember, those are the first two numbers of the sequence that get us going. And then what we'll do is we'll say for int I equals 0, I is less than length, plus plus I. And then we'll say int next equals n0 plus n1. So that's the heart of what the Fibonacci series does, adding together the two previous numbers. But then we're going to have to move those numbers up. So in terms of being interested in the last two numbers, our 0 is then going to disappear off because we're not interested in that anymore. And our 1 is going to be of interest, and our next. So what we'll do here is we'll say n0 equals n1, n1 equals next. So we'll move them up, and then we want to return next. We don't want to return it, we want to yield return it. So we say yield return next. And that's all okay, because remember, we've got the ienumerable of int. So when we yield return, we return the int, which is what next is. And so when we do that, we'll return the next element in the sequence, but we'll remember all of the local status. So we'll remember the new values of n0 and n1. We'll remember the value of I, remember the value of length. But the important thing is we'll pick up where we left off, and we'll just keep looping through until we hit length, then we'll go off the end of the for loop, and then effectively the sequence will terminate. So let's demo that one. So rather than having our days of week, we're going to say for each var val in Fibonacci.sequence, let's take it up to 10 elements and then just write out the value. Run that up, and we can see we're going 1, 2, 3 is 2 plus 1, 5 is 2 plus 3, and so forth. And we can see the 10 elements going through there, or however many elements you wanted, until you start hitting the limit of the size of an integer, which is eventually going to come in there. So there you have it. Three slightly different ways of using yield return. The first one as another alternative for iterating through our library of books. Not as good as simply using the built-in enumerator that we have with the list, but better than writing our own enumerator. And then also we saw where it's really very useful is when we've got something like an enumerated type, we want to be able to loop through a subset, then it was very, very simple and so easy to read is the nice thing I like about that. And then another one, when we've got a situation where we want to generate an infinite series up to a limit, so we don't really have the infinity, like the Fibonacci series, and that was a nice way to do that. So it's quite a useful feature, but that was just the C# version 2 way of doing things. Next time, we'll be looking at asynchronous yield return and how we can use that for writing asynchronous loops. Any questions, pop them in the comment section, do subscribe, and in a week's time, you'll be able to see that one on asynchronous yield returns.